Hello there, beautiful people. Are you ready to hear some more life-changing stories? Well, we've reached the final episode in this, our first series, brought to you in partnership with our friends at TSB. And this is a good one. Now, I'm always amazed at the unstoppable strength and quiet dignity of so many of our winners. And today's episode has that in spades. We've called this one Finding Hope. And I hope it brings some positive energy to anyone who needs it today. We'll be talking to more very special people, people who faced immense challenges, but used this experience to help others too. First up is a woman who needs no introduction, but I'll have a go. She's one of those TV presenters who really can turn her hand to anything. She is, of course, the lovely Christine Lampard, who met her husband for the very first time at the Pride of Britain Awards.
So hello, Christine. Hello, thank you for joining us. It's lovely to have you with us for our final episode of this series. I know you've long been a friend of Pride of Britain, and it's meant a lot to you in different ways, which I hope we'll be able to talk about. Can you tell me a little bit about your very early Pride of Britain memories and then some of the amazing moments, personal and professional, that have happened during your Pride of Britain time?
The Pride of Britain, there are very few nights like it, and I mean I've been going now for many years, and gosh, even just watching it at home on the TV, it obviously has a huge impact on you because you're listening to real people with real stories, and it's wonderful that people can get a pat on the back and be recognised for some of the incredible things that they do. But I have to say, being part of the audience is something very, very special. To be in the room with the award winners, there is nothing else like it. And the feeling and the emotion in the room on the night, honestly, I've never ever experienced anything like it. My very first Pride of Britain, which was back in 2009, it was so remarkable. I'd honestly never experienced anything like it. And also, you know, I still, weirdly, after all these years in TV, I still get a bit excited about seeing famous faces and, you know, looking over and going, oh, there's such and such, and there's a table of royalty over there. I mean, how often are you in the same room as, like, the future king or whatever?
I know.
But even all of that excitement aside, the what the awards are about, I think, is something so special. And every single year, it's become bigger and better and greater and so well recognised. And I think if you're to win one of the awards, it must be just one of those wonderful accolades in life to stand up on that stage. And actually, typically, particularly when it comes to, say, the emergency services type awards, you always hear these people stand up and, well, you know, it's sort of just what I do, and they're, you know, it's part of a team, and it's almost like they're embarrassed that they've won an award because they themselves are just remarkable people that do these things that 99% of the rest of us would not do. It's a wonderful evening. I feel very privileged and proud to have been part of any of it. And like I say, to breathe the same air in the room as some of our award winners over the years has been remarkable. And then, as you say, on a personal level, which is completely aside to everything else, I met my future then husband at the Pride of Britain. So I'm very grateful to the Pride of Britain for lots of things.
And how did that happen then? So you go to an award ceremony, it's, you know, it's just one of those nights. What actually happened?
Yeah, it's extraordinary. We talk about it all the time. It was the 6th of October 2009, to be precise, at the Grosvenor House Hotel. And weirdly, I was doing the one show at the time, and Frank wasn't even supposed to go. And because I had been doing the one show, I was going to be coming late to the awards. And I was thinking, oh, I don't want to walk in the middle of it. Maybe I shouldn't go. And then I thought, no, I've been invited. I've never been before. It's such a wonderful night. I am going to go, and I'll tiptoe in if I can. So that was from where I was coming from. Frank wasn't even really supposed to be there. I think he'd just had a game or whatever, but he decided last minute to go. So actually, technically, neither of us were meant to be there at all.
Wow.
But we were, and it turned out our tables were sort of alongside one another, and a couple of people sort of claim the fact that they were the reason we met. Piers Morgan certainly being at the top of that list because he was at the table with Frank, and I knew Piers. And after, there was a little break at the end of the show, and Piers came over and said to me, oh, there's someone I want to introduce you to, he wants to meet you. And it was, of course, Frank. And then we kind of all mingled afterwards for a little bit, and we started to chat that night. And he was actually heading off to the Ukraine, believe it or not, to play. He was with England at the time, and they had a tournament or some friendly there. So he was away for about 10 days, I think. But we started talking on the phone during that time. And that was honestly the beginning of what is now almost, 13, 14-year relationship, almost 7 years married and two children later. And it was all born out of going to the Pride of Britain and being introduced that night and getting along. And yeah, here we are.
So did you not know each other before?
No, we never met, didn't know anything about him at all. He claimed, that was his opening line to me that night. He said, "Oh, I watch you on the One Show," and I remember saying to him, "No, you don't." And he said, "No, I do. And I said, "Okay, well, you know, give me one of the guests that happened to be on this week," and he was able to tell me, so I believed him. Wow. And that was it. We had a bit of a giggle, and you know, we both went home. But and then he called me actually on my way home from the awards that night, which I thought was quite charming, and just to check I'd got home, which is what he claimed. And that was honestly how it began. But we didn't see each other for a little while after that. As I say, he was away, but we spoke on the phone loads. So weirdly, the next time we actually met was a couple of weeks later, but by that stage I felt like I knew him. I knew all about his family, I knew about his life, and because we'd done a very old-fashioned courtship almost, because we'd just spoken on the phone for ages. So it was, yeah, it was lovely. So we're very grateful we went along that night, yeah, or we might never have met.
And do you know what, in this day and age, you know, an age of like online dating and apps and everything so kind of remote and removed, to actually meet someone and then, like you say, to have a little gap of just getting to know you, is very romantic and old school, but very, it really works.
Very, very much so. And it's weird, you know, it's one of those dates in the year that we always go, oh, that's kind of our anniversary. So the Pride of Britain is sort of alongside all the milestones in our life now for forever, really. Yeah.
Wow. And like you say, now it's kind of like marriage, children, you know, we're firmly down the track. I always ask people this because I always think, so, you know, I've been involved with and part of Pride of Britain for a long time, and now I have children, and I think being a parent kind of changes the experience of Pride of Britain in the way that it changes lots of other things. So has motherhood or parenthood, obviously it changes your life, so I'm always keen to know what surprises people about parenthood, but also how it's changed your experience of Pride of Britain.
Well, weirdly, you're absolutely right, because I always, there are sort of two things in life that have always really struck me in terms of emotion and how I would sort of cry at things. Anything to do with elderly, and anything to do with small children and any form of a struggle. And they're the sort of the two groups that have always really kind of got me, and I have to hold back the tears if I'm doing anything on the telly, for instance, or any form of abuse or you know, anything like that it really gets me. And I think definitely since having children, anything to do with a struggle when it comes to a child, and indeed then the parent's perspective of that struggle, it's hard to contain, and the emotion of it all, really. I even remember, wasn't it just last year, little Harmony Rose?
Yes.
Who really got me, because I just thought, that is, you know, every parent has lived through at some point when their child is maybe a bit sick and a rash appears, for instance. I've been there myself. And thankfully, touch wood, it was fine. But suddenly that little girl's life changed so quickly, as it did for her entire family. And to see her and her family has come so far off the back of that fateful day when you get told your little girl's ill, and suddenly, you know, she's having to have her arms amputated, and even the little tip of her nose, and that really got me last time around. And it's those stories stick with me forever, and I sit back and go, could I do that? Could I be as strong as they were then? And you question yourself.
I know, and I
think definitely all of those stories absolutely hit you like a ton of bricks when you've actually got your own children, because I question constantly how I would be, and I never think I would have the strength that a lot of these parents do.
You do wonder, but you must, I don't know, I've often thought that myself, but I also look at siblings. I often think how brave the siblings are of people at Pride of Britain. Yeah. So brother or sisters on the stage, yeah, and like you say, it doesn't, when something like that happens, it impacts the whole family in loads of different ways. And often the siblings are such a source of comfort. They're so loving and kind, aren't they? And they don't often, I mean, they miss out on some of the attention.
A lot of them are so willing to sort of almost sit aside and put their feelings to one side because they're so nurturing and they're there to care all of a sudden. All the various dynamics within a family when something, any form of tragedy hit is always, it probably resonates with anyone, particularly if you've got children, because let's face it, it could hit any of us at any time.
In terms of just you as a mum, what kind of a mum are you? Are you chilled or are you kind of on it? And how has motherhood changed your life, would you say?
I wouldn't say I'm chilled. I try to be.
Yeah.
And I think I'm chilled most of the time. But I think it's made me much more, I think it's created a form of health anxiety in me, weirdly. And I say that because suddenly, not that I ever wanted to be ill, but suddenly I really think I can't be. Because I have got to be here for you. And so, even just before we went away on holiday, and here I am with a bit of a tan, and I plaster sun cream all over me, but I went and I got my moles checked, and I go for my smears when I'm supposed to go for a smear. I do all the things I'm supposed to do because I just think I have to do my best to be here for you. So that's a big part of it. And then I have a constant worry just about them. I'm like, if I could just zip them up in some form of a NASA spacesuit, it would be wonderful. But obviously you can't. And my two are, particularly my little boy, oh my goodness me. He would be in here right now. I'm in the makeup room at work. He would be climbing the walls. He'd be pulling stuff down. He's oblivious to everything else other than the fact that he needs to destroy the room. And so, yeah, I just worry constantly, like, don't fall and bang your head. Don't do this, don't you? I've definitely become that mum. And I try to pull back sometimes because you can't be completely boring all the time and health and safety conscious. But at the same time, I just think you're so precious that I'm here to try and like protect you. So I've definitely become that mom. And equally so, I have such a great relationship with them. We do have laughs. They make me probably laugh. I try to make them laugh and make things fun. I mean, you're not at school yet, so I think you're at that beautiful time in your life where before you even have to worry about going to primary school, this should be the fun bit.
Yeah.
And so I do my best to have lots of giggles with them. We do lots of things at home. And obviously, Dad, Frank, is away from home now for a lot of the time because he's up with football up at Everton. So we do our best to go up and see him as much as we possibly can as well. So we just try to make it, like doing outdoorsy things. I do like getting outside. And I think it's a lot to do with how I grew up back in Northern Ireland. We were near beaches and near the mountains. And we're not like that where we are in the middle of London. So I like getting back home to do that and do the normal stuff and get the dog out for a walk every day. And so we're quite active and I enjoy that part of it. They've made me a better cook because, you know, I could get by nibbling all day, whereas I have to make a meal for them. So they've made me better at that. I think ahead, I have to be a bit more of a planner. And that's not good for me, if I'm being honest, because I'm useless. I like people just saying, we're going to do this, and then I'll follow the plan. But I'm not good at coming up with the plan. So I've had to become that person, which I've struggled with.
You know, what I don't like is being in an airport. I was never that person in the airport who was checking the pockets, checking the things. I was just literally thinking, I'll get a coffee. Can't wait for my holiday. That's all that was in my mind. Now, on the way there, I'm thinking, do I have the details? Do I have the passports? Because it's all on me. And it's suddenly like, yeah. Well, I'm never going to forget the stuff. Of course I'm not. I've checked it 10 times. But partly thinking, there's a slight tremor, isn't there? It's different.
There's a tremor. I am a list person now. Mm-hmm. So particularly if you're travelling or if I'm going home for the weekend to my mum and dad and stuff, the list I have, because I'll have, you know, whether it's nappies, wipes, milk machine, which I bring sometimes with me, just the list kind of seems to get longer every time I go anywhere at all. And making sure I have plenty of snacks in the hand luggage, making sure I've got stuff that will occupy them, because if they start screaming on the plane and everyone around me will hate me, I have terrible pressure about that. I can't stand that. And so I've definitely become a bit more anxious, definitely a bit more stressed, but it's all for the love of them. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. And you know what, my children are 14 and 15 now, and suddenly I don't know when this happened, but I kind of looked around and thought, I don't have all that stuff anymore. You know, like you're saying, all the kind of bits and bobs you carry with you. One day I thought, we've just got in the car and we don't have anything. I don't think we even have snacks. We've maybe got some water. I've lost the clutter. It's happened. It's really weird in the blink of an eye. Yeah.
That's true. So, and everyone keeps saying, you've got to enjoy this bit. And I get that. I do. And I have to tell myself sometimes, even my little girl who's just desperate to sleep in my bed every single night. And I'm trying to break that like terrible cycle that everyone tells you all for. But equally so, I look at her and just think, you're not going to want to do this probably in maybe even 2 years' time, never mind 10 or 20. And I just say, I love our little cuddles at night time. And I know that goes against every single mothering book that there is out there, but I don't care. I just think you're three. And if you want to cuddle at night time, I'm going to give you a cuddle. And
that's, you know, that's, I remember my mum saying that, because I was saying, oh, they're doing this, they're doing that. My mum was like, number one, who doesn't want to fall asleep with their mum every night?
Yeah.
And number two, do you know any kind of 10-year-olds that do that? No. So enjoy, and, you know, absolutely, you'll have your space back, but also you'll have a gap there and you'll be a bit sad. And you're like, oh no, it's so true.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. So that's certainly where we're at. But we try to have as many giggles as we can along the way in amongst my anxiety.
Are they pals with each other? Are they good with each other?
They're getting better. They're getting better. My little girl who's three, like I say, and the wee boy's one. And if he dare touch anything that remotely belongs to her, even though she hasn't even looked at it for the last 3 years of her life, the second he would have grabbed it, she would have gone, that's mine, and launched in. But that's starting to die away a little bit. She's starting to be a little bit more sharing. And actually, she gave him a little kiss on the cheek yesterday, which I thought was a huge step forward. And they do, I mean, they'll definitely have little arguments, but he's starting to stand up to her a little bit more now, which is really interesting. So at 1 year old, he's already going, no, I'm going to hold on to that. Mm. So the dynamic's changing a bit already. Yeah. But they are, they're very, very good. And then, of course, we've got Frank's older, the big girls, or the big sisters, as my little girl just addresses them both. She goes, big sisters, that's how she calls them. And they're fantastic. They're very, very, very good with them. And they look up at the girls as if they are godlike creatures sent down from heaven. So they've got a beautiful little relationship with four of them. So we're very lucky, I have to say. They all get along very well. And
yeah, I was going to say, I think those ages work really well when you've got that gap, because I think you've got that, there's enough distance, they're not in each other's territory, and they can just bring out the best in each other and be kind. And like you say, they kind of, the little ones here worship the older ones. And
yeah,
I don't know, yeah, they're a good pair of hands. So when you're, as well as juggling and your lists and everything else, obviously you're working a lot. Can you tell us a bit about the stuff you're doing at the minute? Because it seems like you're doing a lot.
Well, do you know, it's a funny one, because I do Loose Women. I'm here today, actually. So obviously Loose Women, which is live and lovely, and it's a really nice environment to be in. So as much as it's work, it's not work. It's actually, weirdly, as much as you're on live telly, it is coming in and having a bit of a chat with your mates. So it's a different form of work, let's say. And then obviously over the summertime, I'm going to be on the Lorraine programme when Lorraine's off for the summer. So I take over in August there. And so I try my best at this stage now to have a good balance, because obviously Frank's away and all my family are back home too. So I have to be really well planned in what I do. And I don't just do things willy-nilly anymore. I don't really ever want to be away from home. And the beauty of live television is you know exactly when you're finished and you know exactly when you can go home again. And so I try and work things as best I can in that I'm just at home more now. And I'm just at that place now, really, where that's kind of what I want to be. I mean, they're only three and one. Like we say, they grow up so quickly. They'll be at school before I know it. And as much as I don't want to completely give up my career and everything else, but it's lovely. I'm very lucky, I think, at the minute, where I've managed to, you know, you can dip in and I do my bits, but equally so, I'm still at home most of the time. So I think right now I've got a fairly good balance, because I just don't want to be away from home anymore.
I know, and it's dead hard to get that balance. And I think if you can work it, because I think otherwise you're kind of miserable, you know, you kind of don't do anything well. If you know, I always have that feeling like, I hope I'm doing both of these bits kind of well, any more on each side, and I think I'm bored and my brain won't be engaged, or I'm going to feel like I'm a rubbish mum. So it's kind of like, you've got to balance it. And like you said, at the end of the day, I wanted just to be, have everyone tucked up in bed, like bathed, you know, read to, fast asleep, maybe. And and then sitting on my sofa, you know, that was the joy.
Equally so, Claire, I know I'm lucky to be able to have that balance. Like, there are so many people can't, and as you say, then it's so, so difficult, because then you feel like you're being pulled in all directions, and like that struggle's real for so many people. Like, I've got a friend who's a doctor, and you know, they work so hard and the hours are difficult, and yet the children are young, and it's just very, very difficult sort of managing reality a lot of the time. So, like I say, if I can, I just enjoy being a mummy these days. To be honest, I really do. I enjoy just being at home and plaiting hair and painting her face like Elsa, like I had to do yesterday. And just, yeah, all the little basic things that I think this is, you know, I had children later in life. And I think, well, I've really enjoyed myself up to now. I've done all the party. I'm really happy now to do that bit. So, and I feel very grateful that I have the chance to.
I think that's a great place to be. Like you say, where you think, do you know what? I had this kind of life, and then this other kind of life came along, and that's amazing. I think it's. I always felt that. I kind of thought I enjoyed that bit, and now I really enjoy this bit. And every bit seemed to be, you know, it seemed to kind of get better with kids. I remember going, ooh, this is a great age. And someone was like, well, you said that when they were like you say, your kids' age now, I think they're really cute ages. Then like early pre, I don't know, it's all quite good, isn't it? But it's still enjoyable.
It's another year before Patricia has to go to school, which is brilliant only because of what Frank's doing and him being away from home. It just means that at least we've still got freedom for 1 year before you have to properly start at school. So I'm just going to try and embrace the next 12 months as best I can, and then we'll see what happens. I never plan ahead too far.
No, and I think actually you do well not to, in a way, isn't it? Because I think, like you said, the nature of your husband's job is it's a certain kind of job where it's not, he doesn't just go to the same office for 20 years, does he? So
no, absolutely not.
It's tricky, yeah. Do you think your kids will be into football?
Well, they certainly are fully aware of what it is, daddy's involvement. Our little girl, apparently, according to Frank, has a great right foot. No idea how Freddie will pan out just yet, but certainly our little girl manages to kick the ball like it's the most natural thing in the world. And it's really bizarre watching. I mean, I couldn't tell you whether it's good or bad, but Frank's really quite impressed with her, I have to say. And she has this ability of almost still talking to you and being able to kick it. It's like she doesn't have to look at it. Yeah. So, who knows? It could be another Lampard number 8 at some stage with my little girl.
Would you play for Northern Ireland or would you play for England? What would you do?
I know we've discussed this before. I would be very, very happy with her in the green and white. Obviously, Daddy wants her in the England colours, so I'll let her decide.
Oh, well, that'd be a great position to be in, wouldn't it? It'd be really good. Yeah, so this summer's going to be a kind of busy work one for you, isn't it, I guess?
It's busy. And like I say, Frank, it's back. Football starts so quickly and then you're in the thick of it. So, there's pre-season and everything starts so early now. And then obviously the World Cup this year changes things a little bit. So there might be a couple of days off in November. But other than that, I mean, he's up sort of obviously Liverpool way. And actually, I love going up north. Up there is very like home to me. Weirdly, it's much more like Northern Ireland than London is. Yeah. So I'm very happy. We get in the car. Sometimes 4 hours in the car with a 1-year-old is challenging, I'm not gonna lie. But when we eventually get there, if the M1 behaves itself, it's actually lovely. We you know, you're sort of in the countryside a bit. We take the dog, and it's just like a little holiday for us. Not for Frank, clearly, he's going to work every day, but for me and the kids and the dog, we just enjoy it as best we can, and we love being up there and being with him and him seeing the kids and everything else. So I think we've got a fairly good balance over the summertime. He'll be busy and so will I, but then September comes and it changes again. So yeah, we make the most of it as best we possibly can.
Yeah, and then we'll see you back at Pride of Britain, we hope, then in the autumn. You can come back and celebrate your anniversary with us.
Absolutely, yes. And funny enough, COVID now has confused me with dates, but one of the last times we went and Holly Willoughby came with us, we all got ready together and we just made such a lovely afternoon of it. We got all, you know, we got our hair done and we all got in the car and we went together. It was just the best evening, it really was. And anyway, yeah, we'll definitely be there again. Yeah, getting dressed up is quite, I find that challenging nowadays. I'm not good on red carpet situations. Once I get that bit done, I enjoy my night. I don't like that, but I get really nervous. Like, oh, I'm really awkward in my own skin. Oh. Anyway, we'll get past that bit and then I can have a nice night.
We'll be there to guide you and welcome you.
Yeah.
Oh, well, look, that seems like a lovely note to end on. So thank you so much for your time and your continued support. And we will see you in the autumn.
Thank you so much, Claire. We can't wait to see you all again. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks, Christine. Now, a lady who has an amazing amount of energy and a remarkable take on life is charity boss and campaigner and nurse, Karen Johnson. Karen lives in Rochdale in Lancashire, and she has endured more than most of us can ever imagine. Two of her children, Simon and Mikey, passed away when they were just 12 years old after suffering from a rare genetic disorder known as Hunter syndrome. Karen set up a charity in their memory, the GEM Appeal, and she has raised millions of pounds for testing and research, as well as promoting awareness of the condition and many similar conditions to it. She won a Pride of Britain Special Recognition Award in 2016, and it was a real honour to meet her there. But we've caught up with her to hear more about the experiences that have shaped her and the people who love and support her. Karen Johnson, you're incredible, and so many people owe so much to you. You know, you, if anything, personify hope through what, you know, you have been through. And we're going to come on to that. But first of all, I want to ask you about the night. Well, the night you got your Pride of Britain Award in 2016, but also how you were surprised to learn that you'd won. Tell us about that.
Well, I got approached by, I got a phone call from some guy saying that they wanted to do a documentary about outstanding fundraisers. So I thought, oh, well, that sounds like fun. So he said they were going to come to Rochdale and do some filming of us at home. So they came along and we got Harry, one of the young boys with the same disorder that my boys had. And we did some filming, and they sort of slipped into conversation that they were staying in Rochdale overnight. Yeah. And I said, oh, that's a coincidence. I said, we've got a fundraising event tomorrow. I said, it's at the hospital where I work. I'm a nurse. And it was in the social club, and we had a rock night. So one of my colleagues was a singer in a rock band, so we used to have this rock night. So it was pies and peas, proper northern pies and peas, and yeah, a bit of a knees up at work. And so they came along and they were filming, and I found it sort of quite normal, really.
Yeah,
they were just filming us doing something.
And this wasn't a documentary filmmaker. This was us lying to you at the Pride of Britain, wasn't it, really?
Absolutely, yeah. But I didn't know at the time.
No.
And and all of a sudden, we thought the pie man had arrived from Carl's Pasties in Bolton, bit of an advert there. Yeah, the Carl's Pasty man. And then walked Peter Kay with his double shovel. And it was like, whoa, what's going on? So he joined the band and started playing. He did one song. And then he stopped and he said, actually, you're not being filmed for this documentary. He said, you've won a Pride of Britain Award. And I thought, and I stood there and I thought, well, I know, because I got one last year, because the year before I was Bernarda Reports.
The regional
winner. Yeah. I went down to the big thing in London. And I thought, all right, I'll just go along with this because I got it last year. So I'm not sure why you're mentioning that now. But anyway, he brought me up on stage. He said, no, he said, you've got Special Recognition Award. And I was like, oh. How? Yeah, it was surreal. It was absolutely surreal. But Peter Kay was so lovely. Everybody that was there, I was so pleased that people had spent £4 to come to our function to support us with a GEM Appeal, and they got Peter Kay. And it's like, all you out there that didn't bother coming.
And they got a pie.
And they got a pasta, yeah, and some beans. So, yeah, it was fabulous. It really was good, and I was so chuffed, and it was lovely to go back down the year after and do it properly, so to speak. Not that it wasn't the year before, but we got spoilt rotten and went on the bus and met you, of course, the night before, and it was just, it was so special but so surreal and fabulous. Met some fantastic people.
So let's talk about you know, your background and what uh-huh. happened, you know, because both of your young sons died a long time ago now, admittedly, yeah. but, you know, I'm sure the pain is still there, from the genetic disorder, the Hunter syndrome.
Yeah.
And just tell us how that happened, because you had your first son, Simon, and perfectly yeah. fine until something happened.
Yeah, he developed, well, we were moving house and we sort of were transferring health authorities, and he went for an update for a hearing test because his first one, he wasn't very brilliant. So they thought he had, he needed grommets doing and bits and pieces. He had yeah. to see surgery.
Because he was just a toddler, wasn't he then, Karen?
Yes, he yeah. was, he would have been 17 months old then.
Yeah.
And we went for another hearing test just before we moved from Todmorden area to Rochdale. And the health visitor doing the test said, Karen, his hearing is profoundly worse. She said, you really need to see an ENT surgeon as soon as possible. So we moved to Rochdale and got referred within the week to a guy in Manchester who examined Simon and said, right, we need to take him to theatre. So he went to theatre, but thankfully we were in a hospital where they had a specialist paediatric ENT surgeon and a specialist paediatric ENT anaesthetist. So they took Simon to theatre and really struggled with him because it's very difficult to what we call intubate, put the tube down to keep breathing, tubes open.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they struggled, but while in theatre, they managed to do it because the anaesthetist was so specialised. And they managed to examine Simon and realise that his liver was massive. And he always had a little pot belly, so we didn't think yeah. an awful lot of it. And so they examined him and took some blood and bits and pieces. And the surgeon, while he was a junior doctor, had done some time at a paediatric hospital and recognised that this was probably one of what we call the mucopolysaccharide disorders. So when we got back, when I got Simon back from theatre and we were sat in the hospital ward or the room, he came to me and he said, I need you to, there's something not quite right. We need you to go and see a specialist as soon as possible. So I said, right, no problem. I said, I'll get him home. I'll go and see my GP and arrange it. And he said, no, tomorrow. I went,
jeepers.
Oh, right. Okay. So the day after, we went to see this doctor in Altrincham, and he had all the paperwork on his table. Anyway, we sat down and the secretary came in and said, oh, Mr. Suchabody, you just need to come to take this call. So me being me, I stood up and had a look at the paperwork on the table, read it.
Yeah.
Been a nurse for all the years I had. Ooh,
what's that? Yeah.
That's right. And it said, this child has heptomegaly. And I went, what they're talking about? He's got an enlarged, because that's an enlarged liver.
Okay.
And I read it and I thought, what are they talking about? It must be the wrong child. He's got the different paperwork yeah. on his desk. So he came in, he came back and he saw me reading his paper. I didn't sort of hide the fact I was reading it. I said, why is that saying Simon's got heptomegaly? And he said, right, sit down. He said, I need to talk to you. He said, it looks like he's got a condition called Hurler syndrome. He said, he will probably die by the time he's 5. And it was just like being told just after he'd just had surgery because he had grommets and he needed his adenoids sorting out. So he said, need you to go tomorrow. This all happened within a week. Need to go tomorrow to the Children's Hospital, Pendlebury Children's Hospital in Manchester, and see this guy called Ed Wraith, who turned out to be the most wonderful, wonderful man. He was just amazing. He wasn't interested in adults. He loved children so much. He was wonderful. And we went to see him and he just laid the cards on the table and he just said, he hasn't got Hurler syndrome. He's got a thing called Hunter syndrome, which is type 2 mucopolysaccharide disorder. And he said, we don't know how long he will live. There's nothing we can do. There is very little research being done apart from in Australia. And he said, all I can do is promise you we'll keep him comfortable till he dies. Oh, and it was God, like,
Karen.
And at the time I was 8 months pregnant with Mikey. And he said, if that child that you're carrying is a boy, there's 50-50 chance that he will have the disorder as well. So at the time, it was way too advanced in the pregnancy to do any testing or anything. So we went home with the knowledge that Simon was going to die. And if the baby I was carrying, because way back then we didn't have all these fancy scans, you could learn the sex before they were born or anything. So he just said, if it's a boy, we'll test him. But if it's a girl, she could be a carrier. But if you, you know, if we test him and it's another boy, he said, then so be it. Anyway, sort of lived with this weird sense of foreboding really for the next month. Mikey was born. They took some cord blood at the time and got the diagnosis the day after that he too had Hunter syndrome. We didn't know how long they'd live. We didn't know if any, you know, what would happen. It was really difficult to look at your toddler and your newborn who looked perfectly normal and think, you're going to die. It was just surreal, really, just weird and sickening. So Mikey sort of was fine and we came home from hospital and nothing seemed any different to if we had two normal, healthy little boys, apart from an awful lot of hospital appointments and blood tests and bits and pieces.
You know, a lot of people would crumble at that point. They'd crumble far, 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 far less.
Yeah.
But you didn't crumble, did you? But did you see it like that at the time, Karen?
No, it was, I think, because they looked so normal. There's a certain element of disbelief, really.
Right.
You know, if they'd have been born and you could actually physically see something wrong at the time, you know, it's very similar to the world I live in with mental health nursing. You can't see that somebody's ill, but they are. You know, and it was very difficult. So it's just a case of sort of getting on with life and seeing what was ahead. But me being me, I wasn't prepared to just let my sons die. And I thought, I've got to find a cure. I've got to start fundraising and find a cure. So I started with a raffle. The first raffle, we raised £600, which was quite a lot in those days.
When was what kind of year was it?
Well, Simon was born 87 and Mikey was born 1988. And so this was sort of late 80s.
Yeah.
And Ed Wraith came to me and said, I can see that you're doing some fundraising. We've got a bit of a situation at Pendlebury Children's Hospital in the respect that we've got the unit. There's some research starting, but we haven't got the lab space to develop what we need to develop. So he said, we need some money raising. He said, if you could possibly, you know, if you're going to be fundraising, if you could sort of consider that money going to Pendlebury Children's Hospital, to the Willink unit, he said, we'd be really grateful. So I said, right, how much do you need? And he said, 250,000.
Jeepers creepers.
Yeah. So I went, right, okay. So started fundraising.
That was probably more than the house had cost when you just moved. Yeah, back then.
So it was like, okay, what can we do to raise this money? So I just love nice things and going nice places. So I thought, right, we'll have a ball in Rochdale. So I went to the town hall and spoke to people there and said, look, this is the situation. The Rochdale Observer and the Manchester Evening News came on board and more or less reported everything I did. I suppose it's very different these days. There was no social media in those days.
Yeah.
But they, you know, I seem to be on the front page of the Observer frequently. So Rochdale, to be fair, came on board massively and lots of people started raising money.
Yeah.
Like things like Round Table and all sorts of people to try and find a cure for Simon and Mikey. So we raised, I got a few friends together and I said, right, we're going to organise a ball at the town hall in Rochdale. And we got a free let, which was unheard of in them days, and got in touch with the band and they did it for free. And it was just unbelievably popular. So the ball happened and it was fantastic. And we raised, I think it was about £2,000. And the fundraising started from there, to be fair. And every month then I started thinking, right, what can we do next? What can we do next? And through the years, where I've had a group of people. It wasn't the original group of people, but people have come on board who have become absolute stalwarts of the charity. The General Appeal Committee and trustees have been with me for years and years and years.
So this is what it's called, is the GEM appeal, isn't it?
Yes.
And what does it stand for, or doesn't it?
Genetics, enzymes and metabolics.
Okay.
So it was Ed Raith that came up with the idea. He named it GEM. And obviously the obvious thing is to have a GEM shape as our logo.
Yeah.
And it started from there, really. And we just... me and this group of people who we actually had a meeting last night, the committee members, people have been with me for 30 years. It's just absolutely incredible. I couldn't have done this without them.
Anything like this, it needs somebody to be the driving force, whether it's a corporation, whether it's an NHS trust, whether, whatever it is, it needs a driving force, and you are that driving force. So how do you get the hope? You had two ill children. Was your driving force then about extending their lives past the 5 years that you'd been told was probable?
Yeah, the driving force was that I wanted to find a cure, which was added to when 18 months after Mikey was born, my daughter Katie was born.
Yeah.
And Katie was born and she was tested at birth and she was she's a carrier. This particular disorder, most of the time, is only ever in boys. Boys are sufferers and the girls are the carriers. So it's what's called X-linked. It's come through me to the boys. So,
But Katie nobody in your family before had had it then?
No.
Like your brother or anything like that?
No. It's just passed on from mothers to daughters. But my mum was tested and she wasn't a carrier. So it's what's regarded as a spontaneous mutation at my conception.
Oh, wow. OK, so therefore more research is needed. Obviously, I understand more now. Yeah.
But interestingly, my dad had just come back from the nuclear testing over in Christmas Island when I was conceived.
Oh, had he?
So I'm very interested in what goes on with all that.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So back we go. So your driving force was to find a cure, obviously, for your two beautiful babies.
Yeah. Yeah. And as I say, Katie was born and diagnosed as a carrier. And life carried on until Katie was four and she became unwell and we didn't know why. And she became extremely pale and complained of a pain in her leg. And to cut a very long story short, was diagnosed with leukemia.
Oh, Karen.
Yeah. So all of a sudden, I had two boys who were definitely dying and the potential of losing my daughter as well.
Oh, Karen.
So the day that we found out about that, we went into the children's hospital and it was Ed Raith, that came to me and said, "I'm really sorry," he said, "we've done the blood test on Katie and the bone marrow test and she's got leukemia." And I actually hit him. I punched him. So he just, he got hold of me. He put his arms around me and he just said, "Of all the people I know," he said, "I cannot believe that I'm telling you this." And I said, well, it was just the final straw, to be fair. It was like, what's going on? What have I ever done that my kids deserve this? Anyway, it all got swept along. Katie got taken onto Burkhart Ward and she was hooked up to chemo. And that night a chemo started and it became a way of life that the boys were either well or unwell. If they were unwell, they were in Ashby Ward at Pentonville Children's Hospital. Katie sort of went from being okay through to the infections coming in because of the chemo. And life became just a sea of being ill or being not ill or being well. And it's funny because if we used to get to a Friday and all three of them were well and still in school all week, I celebrated.
Did you? That was like Christmas.
Yeah, every week. And, but as time went by, then you could visibly see the boys starting to deteriorate. But
how old were they then? Because, you know, you've been told when you first discovered it with Simon and then with Maggie that they would probably only live till they were five, but they lived way past that.
Yes, they both died when they were 12.
Yeah.
They were born 18 months apart and they died 18 months apart. But while Katie was at the end of her first 2 years of, it was a trial at the time of chemotherapy, she relapsed and she needed to go back in hospital and they reattached her to the chemo, but her body rejected it and her body started to fail, basically. And the only way that she could be saved was a bone marrow transplant. And they did a load of bone marrow transplant, bone marrow testing. And the Anthony Nolan Trust had never seen a certain antigen in the bone marrow that was in Katie. But the only person who was a perfect match was Mikey. And amazingly, Mikey had this antigen that she needed, or that was meant that she would be a match for him. Anyway, the boys, as part of their condition, their soft tissue is very weak and it's very common for them to have hernias. Now, previously, a couple of years earlier, Mikey had had an umbilical hernia and had surgery and had it mended. But amazingly, at the time when Katie was really at the end of her life and really in a bad way, Mikey's hernia re-ruptured, which is really weird because they don't normally re-rupture. So because of the fact, ethically, you couldn't take my boys to theatre just to take bone marrow because of the breathing problems and the risk to their life. So because his hernia actually gave way, he had to go to theatre to have it mended. And at the time, they took the bone marrow for Katie. She got the bone marrow. She came out of isolation within 14 days and she's never looked back. She's absolutely incredible.
Oh, Karen.
Yeah. So Mikey lived then for about another 18 months and then sadly he likely died.
So in terms of the boys going to school and everything, were they in wheelchairs? Because I'm, you know, like a lot of people, I'm not familiar with Hunter syndrome, you know?
Yeah.
Because it's quite rare.
At primary school, they initially, Simon was fabulous with the football. He was always on the rounders team because his eyeball coordination was fantastic. He was brilliant at cricket. He loved anything to
really?
Do with the ball.
That's amazing.
Yeah. But as time went by, their ability gets lost because everything clogs with these polysaccharides. So the brain clogs and they slow down. The growth is stunted. The heart becomes clogged with these polysaccharides. Basically, they can't get rid of polysaccharides, which is the last product of everything we consume, everything we eat. But we excrete it normally through our cells, through our urine and everything else. Yeah. But the boys couldn't do that, so it stores in the body. And it just clogs and clogs and clogs. And that's what causes them to die. And so they went through primary school, going from running around in the playground playing football through to at the end in wheelchairs, back in nappies, being spoon-fed, being one-to-one supported by some amazing staff at the school. And, so basically their lives go into reverse. So you watch your child from being able to use a computer, play football, etc., to being a wheelchair-bound, poor little soul that, you know,
So, you know, back in at that time, so that was, I suppose, around about the year 2000.
Simon died in 1999 and Mikey died 2001.
And you started the Gem Appeal.
Yep.
And I mean, how on earth you kept going with that, I don't know. Your first target was £250,000.
Yeah.
So how did that go then?
Well, that's what kept me sane. That's what gave me purpose. Yeah, I feel that fundraising, I was fighting it and it gave me a purpose. At the time, I had to take a break from NHS nursing, although I worked in the private sector just some evenings when I could. But I just focused massively on fundraising because it was my way of fighting back against this disease that was killing my sons.
Yeah.
And it was like a snowball that they gathered momentum. And the more events that we organized, the better it felt, because I felt like I was fighting it.
Yeah.
And it was that people came on board. One of the people that came on board who's been a massive, massive supporter and a big part of fundraising is Denise Welsh.
I was with her yesterday. Denzi. Yeah, I love Denzi. Yeah, I love her.
Yeah, Denise and her husband then at the time, Tim Healy, came on board. Yeah, and organised or hosted in conjunction with Entertainment Today, but hosted a winter ball.
I've been to that a couple of times, which is a huge event.
It is. It's massive. It's absolutely massive.
I went to the first one. I think it was at the GMEX or something. Not the very first one, but my first one. Massive red carpet. Didn't think they had an entire ice rink inside.
That's right. Yeah.
I mean, this is. I've never seen anything like it. And I've been to some events, let me tell you. It was extraordinary.
Yeah, it was. It was. And they always have, you know, the year on year, the themes that a lady called Julie Arnold at the time used to put together.
I know her too. I know Julie. She's amazing. Oh, yeah.
Lovely Julie.
Yeah.
And, you know, and the events, those events have been a massive, massive part of our fundraising.
Yeah.
And, you know, and without Denise and that event, we wouldn't be where we are now, to be fair. You know, there's an awful lot of stuff that we've done, and people have come on board throughout the country, people down in Southampton, the lads up in Durham, you know, through into Wales. My mum and dad, God bless him at the time, he's not with us now, but they've sort of got everybody on board with the Rotary and people in Wales. So there's been an awful lot of people come on board. But I'll say, I must, you know, the big thank you if Denise listens to this. I'm sure she will, but she knows how much we love her.
So what was the connection with Wales then? Being Welsh, I like to know.
My mum and dad live in Prestatyn.
No way.
Yeah.
Because I'm a Prestatyn girl.
I know.
For those listening, Prestatyn is a tiny town on the coast. I mean, I don't know what the population is now, but it was about 3 when I was there. But So 2.5 million pounds raised later. It's probably more than that now, is it?
It's 3.4 million.
Oh, well, forgive me. Get that number wrong. That was probably what it was in 2016. 3.4 million pounds, way, 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 way past the original target, obviously. And what has that money been put towards?
What we did originally was fund the building of the lab, where as soon as the scientists got in it, they started doing research trials of enzyme replacement therapy. Now, the enzyme replacement therapy trials started and were hugely successful. And there are lads alive today, young men alive today, who have benefited from being on this treatment. There's David Alton over in Liverpool, and David is now 33. He runs his own business. He struggles. He has a lot of health issues. There's Harry Hudson over in Chester, and Harry has just done his GCSEs and is going to be a farmer. God love him. Harry's the one on the DVD on the film that was at Pride of Britain. On his bike.
And now he's going to be a farmer.
That's what he wants to do. Yeah,
that is extraordinary.
It is, and I think that's what keeps me going is the knowledge that the money that we've raised has actually done something fantastically positive.
Yeah.
And boys these days, there will be a mum and dad somewhere in this country today, or certainly this week, having a baby who's got a problem and they are told that, I'm sorry, your son's got Hunter syndrome. But it won't be a case now of, well, he's got Hunter syndrome, we can keep him comfortable, there's nothing we can do. It is now, right, let's get you into hospital, let's get an intravenous infusion up. If it's a baby and they're young enough, there's stem cell transplantation going on. It's massive, the amount of amount of things they can do now for this, because, you know, are directly due to the money we've raised for the gem appeal.
That is unbelievable. And does it also help with other syndromes? You know, because we've spoken about how there are others that are linked.
Absolutely, yeah. The tandem mass spectrometers and the TCAM machine that we've raised money for now, because that's what we do. When they pull Pendlebury down, we now fund machinery that diagnose. Because as most people know, in any sort of disorder, the earlier the diagnosis, the better the prognosis.
Yeah.
And so the sooner you can diagnose a child with this, the sooner you can start the treatment. And what we're looking at and hoping for, and it's looking possible, is, you know, when your baby is six days old, 10 days old, the health is comes down to a heel prick.
Yes.
We're looking at, and it should be possible soon, that these disorders are included in that.
That'd be wonderful.
So you've got a baby who's a few days old, who you get the diagnosis. Yes, it's horrendous, but there's something you can do quickly and stop the disease taking hold.
And that's through the Royal Manchester Children's Hospital now.
Yes, the Willink unit at the when they pulled down Pendlebury and they moved to the Children's Hospital in Manchester.
Yeah.
Ed at the time, God bless him, he died. But when he was still with us, he insisted that the same degree of floor space that we paid for in that original lab was equated for when they built the unit. And then also the lab is named after my boys. It's the Simon and Mike Genetics Laboratory. And that sign is still up over the door as you go in. Yeah. So
that must bring a tear, does it?
It does, yeah. You know, and because Katie received Mikey's bone marrow, she's now considered a sufferer with no symptoms, which means, because it's a deletion from each cell, you can't take it out of her.
But I see.
She's got Mikey's bone marrow. So her bone marrow is Hunter bone marrow. And they said when she got the transplant when she was 8, they said she'd never develop academically. And then she went and get a 2-1 at uni.
Good girl, Katie.
Yeah. And they said she'd never develop. Well, she's not as tall as me, but she's not, you know, she's not a tiny one. She's a powerhouse, is Katie. She's fabulous. She works at the Lowry in Manchester.
Yeah,
she's amazing, Katie. I've never known anybody quite like her. She's so determined. She takes life by the proverbials and she gets on with it.
How old is she now, your Katie, then?
32. She was 32 just earlier this month. And she got married last year.
Congratulations.
Yeah, to the lovely Lewis. And so she's, happy now. And she's settled, got her own house and husband, job, cat, car, everything that anybody really strives for. Yeah, she's got four dogs like me, though.
But you know what she's inherited genetically is a mother's fight, hasn't she?
I'd say so.
I think that's been handed down. So back to 2016. So you had Peter Kay surprising you with his pies and his guitar, and then that was enough. And then you were obviously came down to the big event. And you know what we like on Pride of Britain? We love our surprises. So you're on stage with me, and then what happened after that?
Well, you said that I'll give you a clue. The person that's going to, the people who want to give you your award want to see you shine.
Yeah.
And I thought, take that. And it was just like, turned round and they walked down the steps and it was just like, I'm on another parallel universe here. It's just this is weird. And yeah, and I've always been a fan of Take That, but I was always a Robbie fan. But out the four of them, I just, you know, there was no sort of, I didn't sort of have a preference to any of the lads. I just loved Take That and I loved the music. Anyway, they were stood there and all of a sudden I did something really weird and I went, Gary Barlow, and I stroked his beard. I don't know why I did it. I've absolutely no idea why I did that. But it's the type of thing my mum would have done. Do you know what I'm saying? It was just surreal. And it was the nicest thing about that was that because everybody in the room had seen my story, and my story does make people cry.
Yeah, it does.
And it's sort of so heart-rending. And when I did that, the whole place fell apart laughing. And it was just like, and I couldn't believe it. But it was lovely because they gave me my award. And then it was fascinating going backstage where you go back round and all the different TV companies and radio stations and everything interview you briefly.
That's right, yeah.
But I was talking to Howard, and he's from Oldham. And
well, they're all round Manchester way, aren't
that's
they?
That's right. Like
Robbie
that's
was
right.
Stoke and that's obviously right. Gary's Manchester and all of that, yeah?
Yeah. Well, when I lived in Todmorden, Mark Owen lived up the road. You had to pass his road, pass his house every day.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, to get to Todmorden. And there was always crowds of girls outside. How, you know, and I look back and I think, crikey, I never thought I'd ever meet you. So, yeah. But they were absolutely lovely. They were so kind and looked after me while we went round that bit. And it's just like, oh, I had loads of photographs. And yeah, it was lovely. But it was meeting everybody else as well. And on my phone, when I meet new people now, I'll sort of start talking about what's what and sort of say about the boys. And I say, oh, I got the Pride of Britain Award. And they go, oh, really? I go, hang on, look, there's me with Tom Jones. And there's me with the Hoff. And the Hoff's at our table, like at Pride of Britain. And they go, yeah.
Well, being a Welsh girl, as I've just said from Prestatyn, yeah. You know, Tom Jones is a god to us.
Absolutely.
He is a god. He's a god not only to all the women in Wales, but to all the men as well.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
He's like the ultimate for us.
That's right.
You know,
that's
we absolutely
right.
adore Tom, Sir Tom, as he is now. Yeah.
But I do use the fact that, or I advertise the fact that the Pride of Britain Award, because the amount of people who go, oh, saw you on it. Yeah. I didn't realise it was you. Yeah. I had a new trainee nurse come to work with us. She's now joined my team permanently, Kate. But when she came to meet the team before she did a placement with us, she opened the door of the clinic room and she stood there and she went, you're the one that was on Pride of Britain with the Jeff with his sons with genetic disorders. And I went, that's right. She said, my son's got a genetic disorder. She said, he's treated at the Willing Unit. It's completely different illness, but like you were saying before, when they use the machinery to diagnose, they can diagnose a raft of different genetic disorders. It's not just for Hunter syndrome, it's not just for the mucopolysaccharide disorders, it's for a raft of different, all the very, very, very obscure, even more obscure than the boy's disorder. And her little boy has one of the disorders. And and she recognised, because obviously it touched her, a part in her when she watched it, because her son was also
because
diagnosed.
Of her situation. Mm. Oh, wow. Well, that is amazing. I want you, if possible, so, you know, people are listening to this podcast and it's very popular, and because it gives people hope. So would you have any advice, really, for people who are feeling down, not in a situation like yours, not like yours, but just down generally?
Well, for me, it's like a big part of my job in mental health nursing, and it's just connecting with people.
Connecting
with people in any way you can. During the lockdowns, our patients suffered terribly with the fact that they couldn't go out. A lot of them, when they closed a lot of the services, a lot of our patients meet up with friends with a similar disorder, just, you know, different illness and things in different cafes in Bury where I work, and you know, and they lacked that, and they became even more isolated than everybody else. And if you've got a thought disorder, or if you've got depression, or you've got an illness that isolates you anyway, to then be told you have to stay in your house, you can't go to the centre where you would go and spend a bit of time doing art therapy or whatever, it's the impact has been massive on my patients, you know. And some of them, the only time they saw people for months on end was when they come to the clinic for their monitoring or for their, you know, the medication that we administer. It's a really difficult one, because when you've got mental health problems, you lack the volition to go out and connect. the fear that people had, and they'd come to hospital and they'd want to stand outside the outpatients with the mask on, terrified to come in. Yeah. And we'd get them into the clinic, and it was surreal for them as well, because wearing a mask as a nurse, especially a mental health nurse, it's really difficult, because it's amazing how much we learn, we communicate by just watching somebody's lips.
Yeah.
You know, and even now, even today, you know, yesterday at work, still had to wear a mask because it's NHS. And there's an awful lot of rise in COVID at the moment. So, you know, having to come to a clinic where you're so familiar with us, and we've got apron on, yeah, mask on, gloves on,
yeah,
and everybody having to stand 2 meters apart, it was just so difficult for our patients, and still is, to be honest.
Well, maybe we should have you back on talking about the, you know, your work side of things at one point, to be honest.
Yeah.
Would be really interesting. We love you lots, Karen, and thank you so much for coming on the podcast. It's always a delight to see you. And
thank you.
All the very best in the future. Well, Karen, you are so special. Thank you so much for talking to us. We wish you all the very best and all the love in the world. Thank you for everything that you do. Now, Alex Hoskin is another mum on a mission. As JK explained, she's created something of a revolution. Over to you, JK.
Loneliness touches us all at some point, and since the COVID pandemic, it's become more of an issue than ever. That's what makes Alex Hoskin's actions all the more wonderful. Alex was a young mum in Oldham, Greater Manchester, when she began to feel isolated. Sitting in a busy supermarket cafe on a wet afternoon, she watched other people sitting alone. She spotted an elderly lady and a young person with additional needs with a support worker, and realised that they probably needed some company too. A trained social worker, she decided to use her skills to make a change, to create a space where people could feel comfortable talking to a stranger. As she says, "I started to think about the positive impact we could have had on each other if we had sat together. I know from experience that when you are feeling lonely, a short conversation with another human can really brighten your day, and I realise that you can be out of the house all day yet have no interaction with another person." She set up her first chatty cafe 5 years ago, and the movement has quickly grown. There are now more than 900 across the UK, providing a place for people from all walks of life to come for a natter. During the COVID lockdowns, their teams of volunteers worked hard to keep people connected, providing telephone chats and virtual meetups. It meant that no one had to feel alone, even during those days of fear and isolation. Alex was recently awarded an OBE for her work, and we think it's well deserved.
Fantastic. Well, if you have something you'd like to share about yourself or someone in your life, please do get in touch for the chance for us to feature them in our regular Your Stories of Pride slot in the new series, Series 2, which will be coming up shortly. We're taking a short break at this, the end of our first series, but we will be back. So all that's left is for me to say a big thank you to all of our guests throughout the series, to our friends at TSB, to the lovely JK, and of course, to you for joining us and being a part of it. You're now part of the Pride of Britain family too. Please don't forget to let us know what you think about this and all of our other episodes of our podcast on our Pride of Britain social media channels. We will feed all that back through and present something maybe that's a little bit tweaked for Series 2 for you to enjoy. I'll be here next time, and we'll be talking to more extraordinary people about their life-changing stories. Until then, we're sending lots and lots of love and joy your way. Bye for now.